My name is Sunil Thomas. Good evening. So, you know, maybe I can talk a little bit about what I do, but maybe I'll go back and talk about, you know, when I was at your age, what I wanted to do, and where I am today based on how I went through different stages of my life. So I used to like cars. Cars are like, oh, you know, awesome. I always wanted to go see how to take it apart, put it back together, things like that. So I decided, okay, I want to go to engineering. I want to do mechanical engineering so I can learn about cars. So first day of class, you know, the professor goes, why are you here? Why are you in this class? And I said, I want to do cars. I want to learn about cars. And he goes, why didn't you go join a garage then? Why did you come to college? You can go to an auto workshop and learn about car maybe in 2 months. You don't have to spend 4 years here. And then he goes, you are here because you want to learn to create. You are here because you want to learn to lead. You are here because you also want to learn how to follow, how to organize. So what school gives you is very different than what you actually believe. It's not just the technical skill, it's a lot of other things. So, you know, I went through 4 years of college in India, and I came over here to do grad school. And I decided to go, you know, mechanical engineering wasn't all that fun. I want to switch to another one. I went to industrial engineering. So this is more about operational aspect of factories, how to optimize the workflows, machines, things of that sort. So I went to industrial engineering. And at that time, there was a company named Universal Instruments in that area. So I went to school in upstate New York. And this company specialized in building robotic assembly machines. So what they do is, you know, everybody knows what a printed circuit board is, right? So you see all these chips that are being assembled. It's not done by hand, as you know. It is completely automated. So this company used to make robotic machines that has computer vision. This is 20 years ago. So they have computer vision. They'll pick these parts out of a big tray, go look at these leaves, align them correctly, and go put it in place on the board. And then you assemble like, you know, 100 or hundreds of these components on, run through an oven, and there you got a printer circuit board completely assembled. So that was my first exposure to high-tech manufacturing. And after school, I got a job at Texas Instruments in Dallas, Texas. And Texas Instruments, everybody knows because of calculators, right? But calculators for them is a very small business. What they mainly do is semiconductor manufacturing, design and manufacturing. So it was, you know, I came from electronic packaging into semiconductor manufacturing, and it's completely different because if you think about it, the most automated industry in the world is semiconductors. So I'll show you something. So this is a blank wafer, silicon wafer. So they put this comes in cassettes of like 24, and this goes into the first machine and goes through various steps of patterning and etching and implanting and all that to make this integrated circuit. And at the end of the day, it comes out with chips. No human touches it anywhere. And these factories are tens of billions of dollars to build, and it's completely automated. So when you think about robotics, that is, you know, applications of robotics are endless, and this is an industry that is completely automated. So a wafer fab these days, they have 100 to 150 operators basically programming the machines and pressing the buttons. So that's about it. Everything else is done hands-free. So then I was in this semiconductor field for a little bit, and then I said, you know, at the time, started talking to customers in various, you know, technical fields. And one of the things I really liked is talking to customers is a lot of fun. And they talk about their programs, their products, you know, 10 years, 5 years, 10 years in front. And then they think, well, you know what? This is really, really cool. So I said, okay, how do I go from engineering to business? So I decided to go back to school again. So I went back to school, did my MBA, and got somehow convinced somebody to give me a marketing job. So again, in the semiconductor field, building chips for other companies. Like in those days, internet was booming, and companies such as Cisco and Juniper, those companies needed chips to move data. So this was like, think about it, you know, you have a fiber optic pipe coming into these big internet centers, the data comes in, it needs to be processed, goes into this machine, so you're moving terabytes of data at a very efficient rate with no latency. That means you need to build this chip that can actually has the bandwidth of taking terabytes of data and processing it and ship it out the door. And you can't do it with anything else other than a microcontroller chip. So that was my first marketing job, marketing to these kind of companies, and I can build a faster chip for them. So we used to build these chips for companies like Cisco, Huawei, those type of internet companies. And then I moved into more, as my years passed, moved into more consumer business. So if you look at, there was a time when cameras went through a migration from film cameras to digital cameras. You guys probably haven't seen any film cameras, right? No one has it anymore, but it used to be the only thing that we had. And the companies wanted to figure out how to capture an image and actually store it and process it and store it. So it's like you have seamless sensor that you build, again, using the silicon process that actually captures your image. But the image needs to be cleaned up. You have to very nice. And the colors have to be sharpened. So there's something called image processing. So when the image is acquired, you put it into this chip and you clean it up. And then you compress it so you can store it in the storage mechanisms. But you need a semiconductor chip for that too. So my team used to build chips for digital cameras in the early days. So we used to build 15 years ago, like 10 years ago, all the Canon cameras used the chip that we made. An interesting story at that time, in about 2004, a company in Cupertino came and told us, we had this thing called iPod. An iPod used to have a ring. Have anybody seen that? Used to be they call it click ring or something like that?
Click wheel.
Click wheel, exactly. It was capacitive. You can actually, it can sense your finger. And they had this idea that if you want to take this iPod and get rid of this click wheel and actually put out a screen, a touch screen on it. So this is in 2004 time frame. So we started working with Apple in building a chip to sense your finger capacitively that can be on a glass. So, my team actually worked on building the chip for iPhone 3D, 3DS, 4, 4S. So it was in the very early days of touchscreen in consumer industry. And then a few years later, we moved from Texas to here. And I always liked cars. So I wanted to get into the automotive industry. Like I got a job in Cyprus Semiconductors, and they were trying to build this business in automotive field. So I got to run it, and this was the time. So I talked about touchscreen in phones. The cars were like, okay, we want to build human machine interfaces in cars as well. Then I see you guys in the robotic room using a joystick to interface with a robot, right? So that is a way of interacting with the machine. Cars, though, in the early days, like if you go back 8, 9, 10 years ago, didn't really have any modern interfaces for the driver or the passengers to talk to the machine. It was all buttons and steering and a gear shift, that was about it. So in the very early days, Tesla was one of the first companies who actually wanted to build a smartphone type of interface into the car. So I got to see how that industry changed from a button-faced, knob-based system to a completely electronic, consumer, like a phone type of interface coming into the car. So my team built the Tesla car interfaces and then started working with many other car companies to build touch screens into the car. So today, if you look at it, almost all the cars are like very much like a phone, but has wheels on it with a lot of consumer-like of interfaces and technology available within the car itself. So that industry is going through very, very fast change. So finally, even though I did my mechanical engineering, I didn't get to work in cars for 15, 20 years, but eventually I did. So these days, I get to go see cars that are still in the design phase, maybe 5 years out. It takes about 5 years for the entire process from a concept to the cars on the road. So you get to see these things, you know, way in advance. That's one good thing about my job. So talking about robotics, where do you think, which industry do you think, let's fast forward 5 years from now, which industry will use robotics the most?
Okay. Space travel.
They already do, right?
Well, I think that's kind of like the most demanding.
Some industry that doesn't use a lot of robotics today, but will migrate to using robotics the most.
Medicine?
Could be one, yes. Yes.
Possibly even food service or something.
Big part of
like restaurants, food service.
Restaurant or service, yeah. Those are all good industries.
Transportation.
Transportation, okay. So you guys all, yeah.
What was the aviation?
Aviation. They could also use a lot of robotics. So from my view, when I look at all this industry, I think one of the industry that's going to transform the most is transportation, and which is, you hear about autonomous cars today, right? And there's so much money pumped into building cars that can, you know, robotic cars, basically, operating by itself. And it is, if you think about it, it is a combination of technologies, mechanical engineering, so there's a lot of mechanical stuff in there, electrical engineering, because the cars are being converted from internal combustion engine to battery-based systems, that there is so much of software, and there's so much of computer vision, there's so much of deep learning. So when you think about it, almost all the technologies that we talk about today is coming into the automotive industry. Even though they haven't really achieved a very reliable autonomous car yet, probably in the next 5 to 10 years, we will start to see a lot more cost-effective robotic cars on the road. Maybe fast forward 30 years from now, I don't think anybody's going to learn how to drive. Yeah, you can just get in the car and go. So it is a very fascinating industry. So much going on in terms of change, in terms of various aspects of engineering, mechanical, electrical, software, all coming into one industry and changing it, disrupting it like so fast. Okay, so I think I talked a lot. Questions?
You said that you studied mechanical and then industrial engineering.
Right.
But your first jobs seem like they're more electrical engineering and semiconductors?
I would say that was mostly, it was more electrical and mechanical combined. In Europe, they call it mechatronics. Mechanical and electronics together. So I used to work in these, I talked about Universal Instruments, we used to build these robotic machines. I used to work on those machines, which is mostly mechanical.
So how did you sort of, I guess you went through many different fields of engineering then. How did you choose one to work in?
The first one was very simple because I was clueless. So I went to mechanical. And then, I always thought that, when you're optimizing factories, so during the days in India, were like most of the factories in India was run by government, government-owned enterprises, that it was the most inefficient industry you could see anywhere. So when I was in engineering college, we used to have summer internships so we can go work in one of these companies. And so laid back, and no workflow optimization anywhere. You can see machines idle half the time because they haven't optimized how to balance your workflow within the factories. So when I looked at it, I thought, you know what, this is an interesting field. So I need to do operational, which is industrial engineering is all about. So I thought maybe that's a good area to go into. And just because of this internship I got from this company, I got introduced to a new industry, and I kind of liked it. And I stuck with it.
So you said you've seen like cars that are going to come out in the future.
Yeah.
So what is the most interesting car that you've seen?
The cars don't change as much.
Okay.
The technology inside them changes drastically. But then there's another problem because, you know, you design a car, concept-wise, and then you decide what kind of electronics goes in there. And then you start building all these subsystems that are built by many different companies. Let's say it's a Mercedes S-Class car, for example. The 2021 car they started building in 2017. So the downside of it is that the qualification of all these various electronic systems that goes into the car has to be designed 3 to 4 years before the car comes out. So the technology is actually pretty old by the time the car is out. What you see is the latest cars have the Mercedes cars that's going to come out has fingerprint identification. Just like, you know, phones have fingerprint at one time. They took that technology and put it into the car, so you can go in there and the car identifies you, and all your settings and your music and your subscription, everything gets adjusted to who you are. And then they, what else do they have? They have very highly automated driving, just like Tesla has. But more robust because they have LiDARs, radar, and camera system. They have like 8 or 10 cameras. And then they have a camera inside the car looking at the driver so that you don't really have to hold the wheel. And today, the Tesla car, so you have to keep your hand on the wheel itself, right? So they, instead, these guys have a camera looking at you to make sure that you are focusing on the road. And things like that. So you don't see big change coming right away. I mean, those cars will come out this year, the cars that I described just now. But in terms of full automation, it's going to take more time. It's a very complex problem. And the thing about it is pretty simple because, you know, this is when you have another car in front of you or a person, you know the velocity, you know the direction they're headed. So predicting where they're going to go is a pretty simple problem, right? It's a simple data problem. But when you have thousands of it, it becomes a lot more complex.
So how do you go about finding your mentors, given that you're the one designing the future technologies of tomorrow?
Are you my mentors?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good question. So one of the things that I do is to travel around and meet with customers and industry experts, because we really have to design technologies that are 5 to 10 years out. So we have to build pieces that's going to go into, let's say, a new tech that's going to come out 5 years from now. We have to start building those things. So we really need to understand where this technology is going to go, where the industry is going to go. Some of that is based on your own knowledge, some of that is based on customer direction. And so we collect information from all over the world, from all our customers, and synthesize it to figure out, okay, how do we build something that can serve all these needs? From a technology point of view, that's how we do it.
What is the one data point that all your customers want? Because since you meet a bunch of customers, what is the one,
yeah,
like one specific?
So there are still many unsolved problems. and again, I'm going to talk about automotive industry because that's what I do these days. Right? So the each camera that, for example, let's just say cameras, Tesla has 8 cameras, right? And it has a centralized computer. Each camera today is like 2 megapixel, and each pixel is like 8-bit or 10-bit. So how many bits of data is coming? And the camera operates at 30 frames a second. It's a lot of data, like in gigabytes, okay? So those cameras are gonna go to 10 to 24 megapixel camera, and 8 of them. So all of a sudden, here it is, you have data bandwidth that you require like 5 to 10 gig per line. So each camera has a wire that connects and goes like 10 meters, because they, even though the distance may be only 2 meters, because of the way the body is and you have to run the wires, it takes about 10 meters. Now that is the problem, that's not solved yet. So 5 years from now, we will need, you know, it's called a serializer, deserializer chips that take this data and moves it 10 meters. So there are things like that that are yet to be solved that people are working on to get to a point that you have a truly robotic car. Because if you cannot move that data fast, then the picture you're seeing, picture the computer is seeing, is maybe a second old, and that's too much latency. Make sense? Any other questions?
What do you think your proudest accomplishment is?
That is a difficult question. You know, the thing is, when you work in the olden days, one person can make such a big difference, and they could create things that they can say, I did it. It's no longer the case. You know, no one builds anything by themselves. You have to create. You need a very large team to execute almost everything. So, I mean, for me, the proudest thing would be to building those teams that can deliver on it and leading those teams. And that's basically what I do. I'm not a very good technologist, so I'm better at leading the people than building it.
You said you worked on the original iPhone's capacitive touchscreen. What was the hardest part of that project?
Yeah, because the hardest part was working with Apple.
Really?
Yes. So there was a guy named Tony Fadell who was kind of the leader of iPod, who was the creator of Nest. He's one of the most demanding guys that I've ever met. And you know, customers' expectation versus the new technology that you develop and meeting the schedules and things like that was the hardest part. From a technical perspective, you're trying to design something that can do, you know, this magnificent thing about touch screen, but that goes into a phone that is only selling, at the time was selling for what, $500 or something like that, so it has to be very inexpensive. So you can create these capacitive chips that would cost $10 to $15, but you cannot go on a phone. The touchscreen chips on today's phones are 50 cents. That's all you get for it. So you really have to take these technologies that you, and actually cram it to something people can afford in the product that you're trying to sell. And that is not an easy thing. You know, anyone can go create a Ferrari, right? You can throw a lot of money at it. A bunch of engineers can make it. But companies like Toyota makes it affordable for the masses. So building products that does great things at the cost point that the product can afford, that is a challenge. I believe the first touchscreen chips that went into the phones were like 3 to 4.